Good afternoon. We are doing it live right here, doing more at 4 weekday afternoons. We get right down to business with the News Driven Hour right after Ben Shapiro and just before the 790 KBC News Blitz with Randy Wang at 5. It's Motech on Money live on the air on 790 KBC, streaming live online worldwide at KBC.com. And yes, the on-demand Motech on Money podcast, KBC.com, Apple iTunes, YouTube, and all your favorite podcast platforms. Stocks taking a breather today with the NASDAQ pulling off an all-time high. All three of the major averages ended a bit lower today after gains from earlier in the day disappeared, and some investors came away from the latest report on the economy with expectations for more economic slowdown before the end of the year. The Dow, meanwhile, closing lower by 91 points. It was up more than 220 points earlier in the day. The S&P 500 finished lower by just about 20 points. The NASDAQ ended lower by 105 points. Coming off from its all-time record high close of 18,713. Still, the NASDAQ stands at the third highest we've seen in NASDAQ history, with the tech names are taking a breather, including NVIDIA, which pulled back nearly $2 today at 139 and change. Apple down nearly 4 at 230 and change. Meanwhile, the yield in the 10-year note moved up again to 4.30%. That's the one that impacts the fixed-rate mortgage rates, which have been edging higher and impacting real estate. Meanwhile, gold, this is big news, above $2,800 an ounce for the first time. This is the highest intraday and settlement price on record, $2,801.70. That's $2,801.70 an ounce before settling at an all-time high of $2,800.80 an ounce, up nearly $20 on this day for gold. Silver, we'll take a closer look at silver as well coming up here later this hour. With the price of silver slightly lower now, down 21 cents at 33.87. On the economy, the GDP number, that's the economic growth number, grew at 2.8% in the third quarter, powered by another increase in consumer spending. The official scorecard of the U.S. economy, that's GDP, gross domestic product, grew at an above-average speed for the second quarter in a row, rising 3% in the second quarter. Most economists we're expecting a bit of a better performance in the third quarter. Consumer spending, which, of course, is the main engine of the economy, moved up 3.7%. That was the biggest increase in six quarters. Meanwhile, businesses added 233,000 new jobs in the month of October. That was the biggest gain in 15 months, according to the ADP company. That's the payroll company that has its report that comes out before the big enchilada is released. That is the jobs report from the Labor Department. We'll be getting that on Friday. Looks like that 233,000 was well above what analysts were expecting. Meanwhile, pending home sales did jump in September as a big drop in mortgage rates at that time pushed more buyers into the market. Since then, they moved up. Contract signings rising 7.4% in September from the previous month, according to the National Association of Realtors. The price of oil back in the spotlight, the latest report showing a surprise drop in last week's crude oil supplies, along with strength in gasoline demand. Oil prices posting their first gain in three trading sessions. Talk of a potential postponement of production hikes by major oil producers also adding to upward pressure on oil, which rose $1.40 in New York to 68 and change. And Brent crude in London, the global benchmark, moving up $1.43 to 72.55. Meanwhile, it's nervous time again at California gas pumps with another big gas tax hike on the horizon. California's Republican delegation in Congress has just called on the California Air Resources Board to delay a vote that's planned for November 8th on new policies that could raise gasoline prices. Southern California Republican Congresswoman Michelle Steele of Steele Beach led the effort of 12 California Republicans. The board is considering stricter carbon reduction policies that could raise gas prices by nearly 50 cents a gallon next year. Congresswoman Steele will be joining me live later this hour. New geopolitical concerns on the radar screen with North Korea reportedly sending 10,000 troops to Russia to likely fight against Ukraine, according to the Pentagon. Also, there are new reports about Minnesota Governor Tim Walz's connections to China. He's the Democratic VP with Kamala Harris. He's the running mate, and I'll discuss all of that with China expert Gordon Chang later this hour. Gordon Chang, of course, the author of The Coming Collapse of China, the Great U.S.-China Tech War, and on X, formerly known as Twitter, at Gordon G. Chang. Century City Investment Bank Houlihan Lokey said it acquired U.K.-based Britannia Solutions, a provider of tech-driven valuation and analytics services, for an undisclosed amount. The investment bank today said the acquisition of that company would allow it to boost its financial and valuation advisory businesses by also expanding the European presence of the unit. The transaction was signed and closed this week. After the closing bell, the earnings parade continued. Microsoft reporting first quarter earnings that beat Wall Street analysts' expectations. The stock is moving lower in after-hours trading. And Coinbase in the spotlight, down about 4% this afternoon after the cryptocurrency exchange's third quarter profit and revenue fell short of Wall Street analysts' expectations. And speaking of crypto, we see Bitcoin pulling back a bit from its rally this week, right now hovering at around $72,386. Joining us live now on Your Money, the markets and the economy and the whole works now. Joining us live, Jonathan Honig, Fox News contributor, portfolio manager at Capitalist Pig Hedge Fund, author of the book Price is Primary, How to Profit with Any Asset in Any Market at Any Time. Good afternoon, Jonathan Honig.
Frank, great to be with you. And I saw a recent study that holds true to me right now. Roughly a third of money managers are sitting on cash specifically because of uncertainty in the election. So many disparate winds blowing these days, Frank. As you said, the economy issues overseas, but the election is certainly high on my list and I think many investors' list, and therefore sitting on cash almost just waiting for the next week to be over.
A lot going on, as you just heard, and a lot coming up here too in the next week or so. Certainly, the Trump trade appeared to be on this week, and we see DJT, the Trump media company stock, pulling back more than $11 today to 40 and change, down 22%. Gold, which has also been mentioned as a Trump trade, hitting record highs, and even things going on in the bond market also being construed as a Trump trade, a betting against U.S. government bonds. What are your thoughts about the Trump trade, the so-called, versus the Harris trade at this point?
Well, you're seeing some plainly plain irrationality, Frank, back in the market. And, you know, the fortunes of the Trump trade, that is the shares of Trump Social, which is Trump Media and Technology Group, DJT. You know, that stock, Frank, in recent days has had a market cap. It's worth more than the New York Times. It has a fraction of the revenues, fraction of the user base of the New York Times. So we're seeing a lot of, some irrationality come into certain sectors of the market. You mentioned gold up there at an all-time high. I think that's a trend that will tend to persist, regardless who actually becomes president. And for that example, I only look to history. You know, from 2001 to 2011, gold went up almost every year. It went up over a number of different news headlines, if you will. So I do think the move in gold prices is for real. We've talked about it for quite some time here, and it's going to take some time. But that's one investment I think that, you know, we're certainly considering, people should consider taking a look at right now.
All right. And then, of course, Bitcoin in the mix as well, seen as bullish if President Trump is reelected. We did speak to John Najarian, who does have the laser eyes on. I believe you don't have the laser eyes on. We talked to the biggest fans of crypto as well as the harshest critics and everything in between. But what about crypto here?
Well, look, hats off to John. I've been pretty shocked to see crypto make that move in Bitcoin up near all-time highs. But you know, Frank, a lot of the high technology stocks, the Mag 7, if you will, have also come back to life. So crypto's been along with it. You know, the only thing I can say with crypto, Frank, is watch your position size. I think, as you said, when people supposedly have those laser eyes on, you know, they tend to make it an all or none. So they have all their money in Bitcoin or none of their money in Bitcoin. The one that I think watch is BITO. That's BITO. This is an ETF that simply holds Bitcoin. So, you know, if you're looking to kind of get into that space, this is one to consider. Do your own due diligence. But, you know, as always, don't make investing in all or none decision, certainly with something like Bitcoin, even at an all-time high.
All right. What about the Mag 7? They have roared back, including NVIDIA, which near its all-time high. Apple pulling back a bit today, also hitting record highs recently. What about the Mag 7 now?
And Microsoft as well, recently at an all-time high. And Tesla, even surprisingly, Frank, looks like it could be potentially breaking out. I mean, look, I still think that the real move is going to be made in the areas of the market that haven't been talked about, and that is small cap, value, and international. The market, Frank, is so concentrated in large cap stocks, the big stocks. It's concentrated in these names as it's been in decades. So I still feel like if you're truly an investor, not, you know, investing for 1 week or even 1 month, but if you're really looking 3 or 5 or 10 years out, I still think that the international small cap and those so-called value stocks, and in fact, Frank, in a recent study, I believe Bespoke had the number, since the election, since President Biden was elected, value stocks are actually outperforming growth stocks. So there's been this quiet comeback in value. And, you know, those are the names that are like tobacco stocks or, food manufacturing and distributing, things that aren't necessarily flashy like AI, but lower valued, pay higher dividends. That's what I think is working right now.
All right. We see one of the gold miners, Freeport-McMoRan, moving sharply higher today, one of the big movers in the S&P 500. That one held up at the close, up more than $6 at 66 and change. We know we've talked about gold and, of course, silver, and then platinum you've mentioned, which is still well below gold right now. In fact, about a third of the price of gold, right? What do you see ahead here for the miners and for the other metals here?
Rising tide lifts all boats. And I think, Frank, over the next anywhere from 1 to 3 years, maybe even 5 years, we'll see all these different reasons why gold is moving. It'll be fears about international conflict, something with elections, something with inflation numbers. And as we always say, it doesn't matter why an asset's moving, but how an asset's moving. So SLV is the ETF that tracks silver. It's still pretty far below its 2008 high. It's still got a lot of room to run as well. And PPLT, that's platinum, also it's extremely cheap on a historical basis. So just like with Bitcoin, you don't want to make metals your only trade. But, I think now having, I throw out a number roughly anywhere between 2 and 10 or 15% of a portfolio in metals, again, do your own due diligence. But I believe it actually makes pretty good sense. If you really want to be diversified, I just don't think that means only stocks.
All right, of course, a lot of geopolitical concerns that I mentioned at the start here, and we're going to be getting into to that later this hour as well. What about the defense companies, given what's happening and the possibility of President Trump being reelected and beefing up the military and so forth? What do you see ahead on that front?
Raytheon is best of breed in, when it comes to defense. The one that I think of, Frank, that is really a great lesson to be learned from is Boeing. We always talk about the dangers of doubling down and how dangerous that could be. Boeing's stock is down 50% in the last 5 years. It's in danger of being kicked out of the Dow Jones Industrial Average, having its investment grade rating cut. So, there's that old saying where you smell smoke, there's probably fire. So, when we see a weak stock, that's when I think you want to get out. Most people want to add. And Boeing, among the defense names, I think is the best example of that. So don't fight the tape. And with stock, you buy a stock at 50, at 45, 43, 41, I believe that's when you should say, no mas, and get out rather than double down.
Right. That just like, that's what that fighter heard years ago. Roberto Duran said no mas, and that was the end of the fight with Sugar Ray Leonard, as I recall. I happened to have talked to Sugar Ray Leonard recently. He said that was the best day of his life when the headline in the paper the next day was no mas, and everybody remembers when that happened. And on the air live with Jonathan Honig here. And Jonathan, any other specific places where you are putting money now and or taking it off the table?
Yeah, Frank, in fact, the best place, which best country, ironically, I think right now is Israel. EIS is the ETF that tracks the Israeli stock market. And, Frank, there's so much in the news when it comes to the Middle East. Israel is home to so many incredible high-tech names that are innovating all these new technologies. And EIS is a beneficiary of that. I also think it's going to be a beneficiary of, some type of progress, hopefully towards justice in the war. So EIS is one to watch. I also like KT, that's K as in Korea, T as in telecom. Among those telecoms, among those Mag 7 stocks, Frank, that's been rallying, has been Google, which is actually qualified as a telecom stock. And so some of these foreign telecoms, dirt cheap, KT is the one I like. Certainly do your own due diligence. And look, don't be in a rush, I think, now, Frank, more than anything. You know, people feel that they have to have every dollar invested. You've got many, many pros saying, don't be afraid to sit on the sidelines before until the election's over. So cash ain't trash at current prices.
Right, and we see the volatility index, the VIX index, moving up 5% today. A lot can happen between now and Election Day. Hopefully we'll get a chance to check in again with you between now and then, Jonathan. But any other thoughts about what could happen between now and then, including volatility at this point?
It'll certainly be volatile, Frank, but I think we should all certainly be thankful, you know, even amid such, intense debate among different political factions, we still live in the most free, productive, capitalist, individualistic country in modern history. So we're lucky to be here and to take advantage of all that living in a free economy can afford.
And I think, as you eloquently said on this program, America is blue, it's red, and we get to talk about the green part of it here, Jonathan, so we do appreciate it, and always great to have you with us. That is the one and only Jonathan Honig, who is, of course, often, almost every day, as a matter of fact, on Fox Business and Fox News, contributor there, portfolio manager at Capitalist Pig Hedge Fund, and author of his book, Price is Primary, How to Profit with Any Asset in Any Market at Any Time. Jonathan, thank you very much for coming to the line here this afternoon.
My pleasure. Thank you, Frank.
Thank you very much. And out to the freeways we go now on 790 KABC. Motaco Money continues here on 790 KABC. Good afternoon and go Dodgers. The Dow down 91 today at 42,141. The S&P 500 slipping 19 at 5,814. The NASDAQ down 105 off its record high at 18,609. The market was higher early on, but lost steam as we drew to the close. The Dow was up more than 200 points during the trading session, ended nearly 100 points lower at 42,141. The yield in the 10-year note suddenly at 4.30%. That's the one that impacts the fixed-rate mortgage rates, and of course, we're keeping an eye on that as well. The price of oil right now in London moving higher by 48 cents, 73 and change. In New York, up 39 cents back to $69 a barrel. We'll be talking gas and oil prices shortly with Southern California Congresswoman Michelle Steele, will be joining me live shortly. Shares of DJT, that's the Donald Trump media stock, which has had a big run-up this week, pulling back 22% today, down 11 and change to $40.03 a share. Taking a look at the cryptos now, we see Bitcoin up about 500, back to 72,386. It had pulled back during the day today. Ethereum down 20 at 2,656, and Doge 24 hours ago was at 18 cents, now back to 17 cents. Price of gold making big news today, moving above $2,800 an ounce for the very first time. And moving, in fact, closing above $2,800 an ounce as well. That's also big news here. Silver also in the plus column today, pulling back a bit this afternoon. We saw gold touch a high of $2,801.70 an ounce before settling at an all-time high of $2,800.80 an ounce, up $19.70 on the day. And let's bring up that silver price, can we? Down 21 cents here at the moment at $33.87 an ounce. Shares of Supermicro Computer taking a hit today on accounting issues, down more than $16 at $33.07. And now the latest news for you right here on 790 KABC. Motaco Money continues here on 790 KABC. Good afternoon. Nervous time again at California gas pumps. Another big gas tax hike on the horizon. This after Governor Newsom recently signed a bill that would force oil refineries in the state to hold on to a minimum amount of fuel, a policy he pushed lawmakers to pass in a special session as a way to prevent future spikes in gas prices. That was the idea, but this move alone is expected to cause an increase in pump prices here in California. Shortly after that, oil company Phillips 66 announced that it plans to shut down a Los Angeles area refinery that's been around for about 100 years. They plan to do that by the end of next year. Also, we're watching what's happening on the regulatory front. And we see California's Republican delegation in Congress now calling on the California Air Resources Board to delay a November 8th vote on proposed new policies that could raise gas prices here in California. Southern California Republican Congresswoman Michelle Steele of Seal Beach leading the effort of 12 California Republicans on that front. The board now considering stricter carbon reduction policies that could raise gas prices by nearly 50 cents a gallon next year. And joining us live now is Southern California Republican Congresswoman Michelle Steele. Congresswoman, thank you very much for taking the call here this afternoon.
Thank you for inviting me.
Yes, take it from the top and tell us about the effort you're leading now to at least delay this planned November 8th vote that could ultimately raise gas prices again here in California.
You know what? Yeah, we are requesting that I led the entire California Republican delegation in Congress in urging the California Air Resources Board, that, you know, they are about to vote on November 8th, right after the election. That's going to actually raise gas prices almost 47 cents per gallon, but that's estimate of 2023. So we are asking that exactly what the, you know, consumers going to pay, because, you know, it's going to be more than 47 because they said it's not, it's out of date. And then Pennsylvania's Climate Center for Energy Policy actually estimated that it's going to be extra 65 cents per gallon. And these stricter policy on low carbon fuel standards, that this is going to really hurt California's working class people. And you know what? Governor Newsom's policy worsening the cost of living crisis facing Californians and trying to hide their actions in process. If we don't go through each details, what they are doing, try to raise everything, then you know what? Most of people don't even know that what they are doing. So this has to be stopped, and they have to really show us that updated. They have to be very transparent that how much really going up. According to 2023 study, it's 47 cents, but by 2030, it's over 85 cents. But according to the Pennsylvania's Climate Center, if it goes up 65 cents in 2025, then it's going to be over $1 2030. And this one, as of now, California, we pay 68.1 cents California tax. We are highest in the nation. How can we pay more than that? And already that we are the highest that we're paying per gallon of the gases.
Yeah. Isn't that amazing? And I don't know if you saw the latest report. Sacramento station was reporting that the California Air Resources Board does plan to move ahead with its November 8th vote that is expected to raise gas prices next year, but it will not analyze exactly just how much it will impact what consumers will pay at the pump. In fact, CARB's executive officer gave a media briefing recently, and looks like they're not even going to figure out how much exactly it will cost. That estimate, as you mentioned, 47 cents a gallon. Now they're trying to walk that back, but they're about to do something that they don't even know what the impact will be for you, me, and Mr. and Mrs. Southern California at the gas pump now.
Yeah, taxpayers deserve transparency, and CARB must address, you know, these concerns and provide an updated impact report prior that they vote on November 8th without knowing that what's going to happen to our consumers. How are they going to vote for it? And you know what? Not only that, these rates are not included, the effects of cap and trade carbon policies. So that drives prices even higher in California. So you know what? We are paying higher and higher. And, you know, average California household is paying over $1,200 more per month for groceries and other expenses since Biden-Harris administration took charge. Now adding Governor Newsom's on the top of it. Actually, I feel like I'm paying more than $1,200 per month. That these are all hidden taxes. This really hurts hardworking class and low-income people and hardworking people in California. It hurts so much. And do you know how many people have gas-powered cars registered in California? 25.6 million people. These people are going to be affected by this. And you know what? Before any regulations, stricter regulations that they want to impose, before to do that, they have to let people know exactly for how much consumers are going to pay, how much it's going to be out of pocket, how much they have to pay more. And, you know, this is not having done, you know, by Governor Newsom and Governor Newsom's policy. It's just not just high income taxes, but on the top of it, now gas taxes that, especially in Southern California, we all have to drive. All these moms driving kids to school and back to work, to go to, you know, markets, to go to just shopping. And this is going to cost much more to hardworking people.
Absolutely. All of this putting upward pressure on inflation, which you properly note here with California leading the way in all this, given what's happening on the policy front. Give me $1,200 on pump number one. That's what we're going to have to start saying pretty soon if this continues here. It's you don't know whether to laugh or cry with what we're seeing here now. And of course, the other recent announcement requiring refineries to hold on to a minimum amount of fuel, that's also putting upward pressure on gas prices. And now the recent announcement that Phillips 66, which has had a refinery here in the Los Angeles area for 100 years, plans to shut that down by the end of next year based on what's happening here in California. That's expected to impact price as well and certainly jobs and the economy there in the South Bay. So all of this happening here in California. What's your reaction to all of this?
You know what? The Phillips 66, they are shutting down. And we never, actually in California, that Democratic majority, supermajority, and what they did was we have our own oil. We can do it environmentally, very safely, you know, drill those oils in California since 1994, never gave out the permits. These oil companies, when they are, like, they took all the oil out from one pipe, when they moved, they needed another permit, they never got it. How are they going to drill and then, you know, they can get, you know, all these oils without importing from other companies, especially Russia and other countries. And those are not even good oils. We can do it clean way, but we are not doing it. And then, you know, this our regulations that they make it stricter. CARB must delay this vote and they have to spend extra time fully informing the public on the effects of these amendments because nobody knows exactly, is it what, really 47 cents or is it 65 cents per gallon? And every time you go to a gas station, we are very scared because as of now, that because of the Biden-Harris administration's inflation, that we are paying much, much more other stuff. This is not the time. And transparency is the problem in California with Democratic control. That, you know what, they have to show us what kind of study. What's real estimate, what we have to save to pay gases, what we have to do it. You know what? Nobody really knows under Newsom and under Biden and Harris. You know what? We have to make it very clear. Those elected people, we have election coming up. We have to vote right people to get there. So make sure that we all work together for working class Californians.
On the air live with Congresswoman Michelle Steele, Republican here in Southern California, and certainly a big difference in energy policy between the presidential choices here coming up less than a week from now, right?
Mm-hmm. It's totally day and night. So you know what? We are working on very hard right now because 2017, President Trump's tax reform that they lowered corporation taxes from 35 to 21%. And then for business, small business owners, 199A, 20% of the income tax you can go through, you know, deduct when those are qualified small businesses. And then low-income families, standard deductions were doubled. They keep talking about that, Republicans talking about just cutting only rich people's tax cut. That's not really true. And most of those taxes are expiring next year. So we really have to be in majority. And Ways and Means Committee has been already preparing since last year under Chairman Jason Smith. We already had more than 100 meetings in 19 different states. We are going out there and listening to the people and what they really need and how we're going to keep it, the low taxes for, you know, all the United States people, because these citizens, they are the hardworking citizens in the nation, and they don't need higher taxes. You already heard the, you know, Kamala Harris already went out. Corporation tax has to be 28%. You know what? These corporations actually create a lot of jobs. We need more jobs. We need lower taxes. We need lower regulations like this. And you know what?
Southern California Republican Congresswoman Michelle Steele of Seal Beach, thank you very much for joining us live here this afternoon on MoTeC on Money on 790 KABC. MoTeC on Money continues here on 790 KABC. North Korean troops in Russian uniforms heading toward Ukraine, according to the Pentagon. Defense Secretary Austin saying today the North Korean troops wearing, yes, Russian uniforms and carrying Russian equipment are moving toward Ukraine in what he called a dangerous and destabilizing development. He was speaking at a news conference in Washington with the South Korean defense minister as concerns grow about North Korea's deployment of as many as 12,000 North Korean troops to Russia. The U.S. and South Korea say some of the North Korean troops are heading to Russia's Kursk region on the border with Ukraine, where the Kremlin's forces have struggled to push back a Ukrainian incursion. New concerns on the geopolitical front. This is the very latest. Let's bring in China expert and regional expert Gordon Chang. Gordon Chang authored The Coming Collapse of China and the Great U.S.-China Tech War. His latest book, by the way, is Plan Red, China's Project to Destroy America. Gordon Chang, thanks very much for taking the call. I know you've been following these latest reports very closely. Give us your reaction to that latest news that I just described.
Yeah, these reports are important because North Korea is sending its best soldiers, not cannon fodder, as many people have reported. These are special operations soldiers. Now, the issue is whether they are going to fight in a special operations mode or whether they'll be general soldiers. But they are heading to Kursk, which is a place for Russia, where they've been pushed back by Ukraine, and Ukrainians' forces are in Russia. The thing here, it appears that they're going to send about 13,000 troops. That's four combat brigades. But we don't know if this is the extent of North Korea's sending of troops. They could be sending a lot more. And if they do, that would be, as people say, a game changer.
Tell us how it would change the game as North Korean troops would be put into the mix there.
Yes, well, it shows that North Korea and Russia are actually working very closely with their alliance that was put together in June when Vladimir Putin went to Pyongyang. But it also shows that among the four now called access partners, you have Russia, China, Iran, North Korea, they all are actually working very closely in Ukraine, which means they believe that this is where the world will be won or lost for them. And so they're putting everything into this. And I think that China actually masterminded this agreement between North Korea and Russia because it serves Chinese interests as well as Russian ones.
Tell us about China's involvement in the situation. Obviously, North Korea and China are very close. Tell us about the significance of all that.
Well, both China and a lot of people say, well, China doesn't like this because it shows North Korea and Russia are closer together. But I believe that China believes that neither Russia nor North Korea could betray it because both Russia and North Korea need China a lot. And so they couldn't afford to betray China. And I think that's a correct assessment, especially when we see that China's interests are benefited. They want to see Russia win in Ukraine. They want to make sure that North Korea gets Russian assistance because that means they don't need Chinese assistance. And China is not taking any heat for this. So it's accomplishing a lot of purposes and not getting any blame for this.
And the significance of the North Korean troops wearing Russian uniforms, right?
Yes. And that's interesting because the problem for North Korean troops is not that they aren't good. They are. But if they are led by Russians and their communication problems, then the North Korean troops probably will not be used well. And in that case, they could very well be ground up by Ukraine. Also, the North Korean troops don't have much experience with drone warfare. And as we've seen throughout this conflict, drones have been a very significant factor for both sides. So the North Koreans are going to have to learn some new tactics very quickly. And they're going to have to do it by being on unfamiliar territory.
Very serious developments. We're on the air live with Gordon Chang, author of The Coming Collapse of China, The Great U.S.-China Tech War, and his latest book is Plan Red, China's Project to Destroy America. Turning to the domestic frontier with China, a big issue. New reports about Minnesota Governor Tim Walz's connections to China. He, of course, is the Democratic vice presidential pick by the current Democratic presidential nominee, Kamala Harris. Who is Jenna Wang?
Well, Jenna Wang is a daughter of a senior Communist Party official. Tim Walz, in the late 80s, had an affair with her. She believes that Walz was going to marry her and then turned around and jilted her. She has now told her story where she said that she actually thought about suicide after Walz dumped her. And this is not a good look for Tim Walz, but again, it's a personal story. The problem with Tim Walz is not Jenna Wang. It is really just his ongoing contacts with the Communist Party's United Front Work Department. Those contacts have spanned over four decades, which means that Tim Walz actually has some sort of a relationship with the Communist Party. The United Front Work Department is the part of the party that subverts foreign governments. And again, this is not what a vice presidential candidate will want to have people discuss in the run-up to the November 5 contest.
Coming up less than a week from now, Gordon Chang, thank you very much for taking the call. Wish we had more time, but we'll have to stop there for the moment and look forward to speaking with you again very, very soon. That is Gordon Chang, author of The Coming Collapse of China, The Great U.S.-China Tech War. His latest book is Plan Red, China's Project to Destroy America. He's also, of course, on X, formerly known as Twitter, at Gordon G. Chang. Gordon Chang, thank you very much for joining us live here on MoTeC on Money on 790 KABC.
Every week, Michael Rosenbaum is getting deep with someone new on the Inside of You podcast. Actor James Marsters.
Are you somewhat content? Do you still stress a lot?
If anything, I feel guilty that I have it so good. If you make the decision to be an actor, the deal is poverty. I don't understand. How did I get here? You know? And the answer, how did I get here, is really one audition one day for Buffy the Vampire Slayer.
Inside of You with Michael Rosenbaum, wherever you listen.